Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the UnidosUS virtual roundtable on COVID-19 and the unequal impact on Arizona's Latinos. My name is Liz Salazar. I'm a policy advisor for UnidosUS, and I live in Phoenix, Arizona. A couple of housekeeping items before we start. The session will be recorded, and everyone will receive an email with a link to the recording. The chat box has been disabled, but you can still submit questions via the Q&A box. At the end of the program, we'll share some suggestions on how you can take action today, so be sure to stay until the end. And now to the program. It's my honor to share the screen tonight with four leaders in the healthcare space in Arizona. But first, Arizona State Senator Rebecca Rios will provide some welcome remarks. Rebecca Rios is the current senator for Arizona's District 27. She served as the former Democratic leader of the House of Representatives from 2016 to 2018, and is the first woman in the history of Arizona to hold that title. Senator Rios led a Democratic caucus that was majority female, also a first in Arizona history. She has earned a number of recognitions and awards for her commitment to serving her community, including the Humanitarian Award from Valle del Sol, one of UnidosUS's 11 affiliates in Arizona. Welcome, Senator Rios.
Thank you very much. And hello, everyone. It is truly my distinct honor to be on this panel with so many distinguished folks. Thank you for allowing me to participate. Let me just jump right in by setting the stage, setting the Arizona stage, if you will. As many of you may know, Arizona right now is number one in the country in terms of our coronavirus epidemic. 2 days ago, we made yet another record. We had nearly 3,600 new confirmed coronavirus cases. I think we are hovering around 1,600 folks that have passed from COVID-19 in Arizona. We are now in the unique situation where we see hospitals entering surge capacity. And a few days ago, they asked the governor for authorization to begin to address crisis standards of care, essentially to allow them the authority to triage and, based on a number of factors like age, condition, lifespan, et cetera, determine who gets a ventilator, who gets care, who gets sent home. And so we are truly in a crisis state in Arizona. When we look at Latinos in Arizona, according to our Arizona Department of Health Services, what they are saying is that we comprise 26% of the COVID-19 cases. But it's very important to recognize that there's a whole nother category, 40%, that are unknown in terms of their race and ethnicity. And that is very troubling because there is good reason to believe that Latinos comprise a number of that 40% that are quote unquote unknown. Part of the problem from a political perspective is that when the governor issued a number of his orders, one of his orders required laboratories to collect data on age and gender, but unfortunately he did not make that same requirement of race and ethnicity. So what we have is also a concern when we look at the department's number of deaths. Right now, Latinos are accounting for 20% statewide, but again, we have 13% that are in that category of unknown. And so we have concerns there. Lastly, we are keeping no data in terms of race or ethnicity when it comes to testing. So I mentioned that because right off the top, there are a number of glaring problems, I think, that prevent us from having a clear picture of the full impact of COVID-19 on Latinos in Arizona. Now, what we do know clearly is that the cases continue to rise. They continue to rise in many of our Latino communities, which are being plagued with the highest rates of infection. And this is coupled, again, with a severe lack of testing in underserved and people of color communities. A couple weekends ago in Maryvale, Arizona, where the Latino population is 75%, there was a day of free testing. There were literally hundreds, if not thousands, of folks waiting in line in their cars in 108 degrees, upwards of 13 hours in order to be tested. You know, some ran out of water, some ran out of gas, many just quit. This last weekend, they did another round of testing. And by 8 a.m., they had filled capacity. So clearly, Arizona is lacking in terms of providing adequate testing, and particularly in our Latino communities. Now, why is this? I've been around in Arizona politics for many years, since 1995. And I will say that from my perspective, Arizona has been failing working families and working Latino families for decades based on the policies that have been implemented. This pandemic did nothing more than to expose the cracks in the foundation, if you will, and our inability to address statewide emergencies, and again, particularly to react and respond in communities of color and in the Latino community. Now, when we talk about Latino children, and I'm a social worker by profession, have worked with children for many years, Latino children were already vulnerable prior to the COVID epidemic. They're less likely, 1.5 times less likely to be insured. When you look at overall well-being indicators, Arizona ranks 42nd when we look at indicators with regard to health and insurance and poverty. When you look at the undocumented population in Arizona, politics has made an impact. Back in 2004, Proposition 200 was passed by the voters, which essentially forbids us from providing state dollars to insure undocumented folks. When you look at who is being directly impacted right now by this virus and who is having to go out daily and work, who are these essential workers? A large number of people of color, right? A large number are Latinos. These are folks that are on the front lines in food and agriculture, in delivery, in warehouses, in hospitals, in the hospitality industry. And so what we have are families that don't have the luxury of self-quarantining, workers that don't have the ability to work from home. They have to go to work every day and subsequently are coming home and oftentimes unknowingly exposing their family. So as a legislator, what do we do about this? And there are a number of things that we can do. We need to go into a special session. Last month, you know, there's a lot of frustration. There are many of us that have called on the governor, bring us back into special session. We need to address these issues now and not let this languish. There are worker protections that we can employ. We need to ensure that workers have adequate PPE. We need to ensure that if there is a political will, that workers be given paid leave. If there is the political will, and again, these are the big ifs, right? This is where the policy and the politics come into play. Arizona has amongst the lowest unemployment insurance weekly amount in the country, if not the lowest. That is something that we need to look at as federal benefits will be lapsing by July 31st. We have a unique situation I learned about here in Arizona with regard to the hospitality industry. And again, a lot of Latinos working in that industry in which they were laid off are now being hired back, but are losing seniority, are losing benefits, and being started over at a beginning wage. And so with regard to workers, there's a lot we can do. Clearly, we need to allocate more money for testing and ensure that it is culturally relevant, that community education is occurring in appropriate languages. I represent the community of Guadalupe, and a few weeks ago they had free testing. And I went in and you know, met with the folks doing the testing, and at that time, this was about 3 weeks ago, the response rate that they were getting from community folks in terms of positive results was at 45%. A lot of that was related, again, to living conditions, multi-generational, to essential workers, to a lack of community education. There had been events, I believe, over Easter, et cetera. So there is a lot that we can do. I think that time is of the essence, and the ability for us to act and to act in a way that is going to be most impactful requires that we act relatively soon. And so with that, I will turn over my time. But thank you all for being here.
Thanks, Senator Rios. Clearly, this is a very timely issue, and I'm glad we're having this discussion. Let's welcome our panelists for this conversation. First, we have Zaida Dedolph, who serves as the Director of Health Policy at Children's Action Alliance. Her legislative experience is focused on addressing barriers to health equity, including improving access to physical and behavioral health care, housing, food security, and financial well-being. Next, we have Robert Guerrero, who serves as the chief of the Office of Border Health for Arizona Department of Health Services. Mr. Guerrero functions as the primary liaison and point of contact between the Arizona Department of Health Services and the public health authorities in the state of Sonora. He has served as the ADHS Director's Delegate to both the United States-Mexico Border Health Commission and the Arizona-Mexico Commission Health Services Committee for the last 15 years. As the Director's Delegate, Mr. Guerrero works closely with public health authorities in all 10 of the states on the U.S.-Mexico border and with both federal governments. Next, we have Dr. Uriel Castañeda, who is a general pediatrician with Mountain Park Health Center and provides primary care to pediatric patients in West Phoenix and newborns at Banner University Medical Center Phoenix campus. As somebody who grew up without having health insurance or access to affordable primary care, he's extremely grateful to have the opportunity to provide comprehensive care to Arizona's children. In addition to his clinical work, he serves on the board of directors for Open Hearts Family Wellness, which provides integrated mental health and wellness services to the families in the Phoenix area. And finally, we have Matthew D. Snyder, a colleague of mine and a senior policy analyst with UnidosUS. In this position, his work encompasses health coverage and care, including children's coverage, as well as nutrition and food security. Bienvenidos a todos. So let's get into our first topic, healthcare coverage for Latino children. Zaida, let's start with you. What was the state of coverage disparity prior to the pandemic, particularly for Latino children?
Thank you, Liz, and thank you to Senator Rios for your introduction. In 2018, Arizona ranked 49th in the nation for the rate of children with health insurance. And though the Affordable Care Act led to a rapid decline in the rate of uninsured kids in our state, we've seen those numbers starting to tick back up over the past few years. And in particular, we've seen an increase in the uninsured rate for Latino children. In 2008, almost 16% of children in Arizona were uninsured. And in 2016, the state reached a record low of 7.6%. But over the past few years, we've seen a steady increase. We attribute this to anti-immigrant policies, such as the public charge rule, as well as hateful rhetoric. And we know that those have had a chilling effect on both enrollment of and use of healthcare services for immigrant and mixed status families. Though almost 45% of children in Arizona are Latino and the vast majority are citizens of this country, Latino children are over 1.5 times more likely to be uninsured compared to their non-Latino peers. And moreover, children who are both Latino and American Indian or Alaska Native are 3 times more likely to be uninsured than non-Latino children in our state. These coverage disparities also vary by age and by income. So older children and teenagers are less likely to be insured, as are those earning between 200 and 250% of the federal poverty level. This is discouraging because although Latino families are more likely to be engaged in the workforce, they're less likely to have access to affordable employer-sponsored health coverage. So what options are available? In Arizona, families earning up to 205% of the federal poverty level can qualify for Kids Care, which is Arizona's CHIP program, or Children's Health Insurance Program. And those earning more than that will likely qualify for premium tax credits to offset the cost of coverage through the ACA marketplace. But for this reason, Medicaid and CHIP, or in Arizona, Access and Kids Care, are critically important to building economic and health equity for Latino families. CHIP in particular is an area that Children's Action Alliance has played a major role in, and that program plays a huge role in providing care to families who earn too much to qualify for Medicaid, but who may or may not be able to afford other health coverage. As you may remember, Arizona's Kids Care program was frozen in 2010 at the height of the Great Recession, and enrollment was restored in 2016, but there was a catch that if federal payment for the program ever declined, the program would once again be frozen. In 2019, we were able to modify that law and to secure ongoing state funding. And as a result of that work, now over 40,000 kids are receiving Kids Care health coverage, though we know that many more than that are eligible in Arizona. It's important as we're having this conversation to note that though Kids Care funding is secure for the time being, the initial 2010 freeze on Kids Care continues to leave the CHIP program vulnerable. states that had active CHIP programs at the time that the ACA passed are subject to various maintenance of effort provisions at the federal level, which basically means that they can't substantially restrict coverage or access to the program. However, Arizona's program was frozen at the time that those agreements went into place. And because of the timing of that freeze with the implementation of the ACA, our program is vulnerable and is not protected from restriction. So though the governor has been supportive of CHIP, we need to stay vigilant and we need to be sure that state funding for this program remains a priority to our lawmakers. Thank you.
Thanks, Zaida. That was some really great information. Matt, what additional context do you have given the recent data that UnidosUS has published on children's coverage in Arizona?
Yeah, thanks, Liz. And I also just want to take a second to thank everybody for joining us this afternoon and to thank Senator Rios for all the work that she's done on these issues in the state. You know, as many of you probably know, UNIDOS is the nation's largest Latino civil rights and advocacy organization, working in the issues of education, immigration, economic empowerment, and of course, health. And UNIDOS has long worked to help develop and ensure the implementation of federal and state policies in ways that improve the health and well-being of all Americans, including the nation's 60 million Latinos. We do our work along with a nationwide network of nearly 300 affiliates, including the Arizona affiliates that Liz mentioned previously. And given that UnidosUS as an organization was founded in Arizona over 50 years ago, it probably should come as no surprise that we have a good network, and a good strong bench of affiliates here in the state. I think Senator Rios and Zaida have both done an excellent job of setting up tonight's conversation, or this afternoon's conversation. And I wanna just kind of give a little bit more texture to this topic, pre-existing disparities, before we pivot later on to sort of understanding how COVID has impacted the state and exacerbated some of these things that we're talking about. As Zaida explained, the Affordable Care Act did make significant progress in covering more of Arizona's Latinos and particularly Arizona's children, Latino children. Unfortunately, like she mentioned, recent research and recent data has shown that those gains are at risk of coming undone. In March, UnidosUS and the Georgetown Center for Children and Families released a national report looking at the overall Latino child uninsured rate in the country. And what we found is that between 2016 and 2018, that rate increased from 7.7 to 8.1%. So the most concerning thing probably about this is that Latino children were already one of the most disproportionately uninsured child populations in the country, and the rate's only going up in the past couple of years. So while the majority of uninsured Latino children only live in about five states, unfortunately, Arizona is one of those five states. And today, UnidosUS and Georgetown followed up on our national report by releasing a state-specific fact sheet for Arizona that digs a little deeper into the details of the state of Latino children's coverage in Arizona. And we'll be following that with a series of other state fact sheets on some states that, you know, are priorities in terms of what we're seeing in the data. So you can find the full details of Arizona's fact sheet on our website, but just to give a kind of high-level overview of some of what the data is initially showing, between 2017 and 2018, the Latino child uninsured rate in Arizona went up just as it did at the national level, but it went up from a much higher rate of 10.1% to 10.4%. I think that, you know, certainly 10.4% is a very concerning figure, but for me, I think the full gravity of the situation can be better appreciated when you understand that that translates to about 80,000 uninsured Latino kids living in Arizona, even prior to COVID, and we know the coverage losses as a result of COVID could make that worse. So I think that we're also able to see in the fact sheet, and you can find out more there, is that where these kids in the state live in Arizona. And what we found is that of the 80,000 that I just mentioned, over 55,000 of them live in Maricopa County alone. So on the one hand, it probably doesn't come as much of a surprise that they do live in, many of them live in the most populous county in the state. But, you know, to sort of harken back to what Senator Rios was saying, you know, it's concerning given what the data is showing, particularly given that Maricopa County has been shown, according to recent state data, to have higher overall case rates among Latinos than for non-Latinos living in the county. So it's kind of a perfect storm where prior to COVID, you already had 55,000 kids, uninsured Latino kids living here in Maricopa County, and you have higher rates and a disproportionate impact on those people based on all the factors that Senator Rios mentioned. So on, you know, just to echo what Senator Rios and Zaida have shared and what the recent data is showing, I think what we're seeing is that even before COVID struck, Arizona's Latino children were in an even more vulnerable situation than other children in the state, with being over 1.5 times more likely to be uninsured than their non-Latino peers. And I think if we pull that back just a little more broadly, even We know that the coverage rates for Latinos in Arizona overall were similarly dire, with about 20% of Arizona Latinos being uninsured, compared to about 8% of non-Hispanic whites. So the immediate sort of takeaway, I think, is that we know that Latinos in Arizona were already in a more precarious position prior to COVID than many of their peers. So I think on the one hand, the good news is that we do know that there are policies and proposals, including some of the things that Senator Rios mentioned and Zaida mentioned as well, that could tackle not only the COVID impact on Latinos, but also some of these child health disparities. And I know that we'll discuss some of those in further detail later, but I think it's important that as we turn the conversation next to how the virus has played out in the state, to understand sort of where Latinos stood going into this virus and how vulnerable they were already. So with that, I'll turn it back to you, Liz.
Thanks, Matt. This information is particularly important to explore considering the impact the current health crisis is having in our communities right now. For our next topic, we'll start with you, Robert. From the perspective of a state health official, how has COVID-19 impacted Arizona Latinos living in rural and border communities?
Take me off of mute there, and you can hear me. First of all, thank you very much for the invitation to speak to you all and to Senator Rios as well for this invitation. And when I look at the Latino population, and we kind of spoke last week a little bit about this, the complexities involved, because it's not one homogeneous population. We have Latino populations that are multi-generational, have been here. Actually, we're here before the United States, probably. And we have Latino populations that are new immigrants to the state. And so when we work with them, and I'll start out with, for instance, in Maricopa County or even in Pima County, and you're trying to craft messaging, you have to take that into account. Because, for instance, I partner a lot with the Mexican consulate. And however, if I am crafting messaging through the Mexican consulate to a family that's been here multi-generation, it can often be, they're not going to accept that message. And if anything, they're going to wonder why it is that I'm using the consulate to contact them. The other thing is understanding that these populations aren't all Mexican-American. There are many Central American migrants that are here. And so I guess what I'm saying is the ability to really identify who the Latino community is and are they multi-generation? Are they from Mexico? Are they from Central America? Where are they from? So that we can make sure that we craft the right messages. Recently, I was working with a group that was also, there are many indigenous migrants that are coming out of Mexico and Central America. And so if I craft my messages in Spanish, these people won't understand what it is I'm saying. So trying to even find out what dialects that they're speaking. In the border communities, all the issues you brought up are even more magnified. When we look at the demographics, first of all, when we look at if you've gone to the Arizona Department of Health Services website, it has the summary page. And when you look at that summary page and it just looking at numbers, Maricopa County obviously stands out when you look at that. 4.4 million people living in that county. However, I had asked people to look at that same page, but change it. There's a little drop-down window that'll change it to the rate per 100,000. And when you change that to the rate per 100,000, you get a completely different picture. And I think you get that picture that it kind of amplifies the disparity issues that we've been dealing with all along in the background before COVID. And so up until today, up in the Navajo Nation for Navajo County and Apache County had been number one and number two from incident rate in Santa Cruz County, where Nogales is, was number three. Well, as of this morning, Santa Cruz County leads the state with the highest incident rate right now at 3,230 cases per 100,000. Now, granted, there's about 52,000 people that live in that county, But when you look at those small communities, and you look at that incident rate, you can see the issues that we're dealing with. Most of our border areas are medically underserved areas, a designation given by the Health Services and Resources Administration. Yuma County, the same issue going on over there. But what compounds the issues that we're looking at is the fact that families live on both sides of the borders. And so I often tell my colleagues in Phoenix, let's say you're working on a diabetes program. If you don't take into consideration the other side of the border, then we'll never be as successful as we could be. I mean, we don't live on an island. And so we're very used to looking at political maps that show United States or show Arizona all colorful, and then when you see the other country, it's either gray or white or like it doesn't exist. But the reality is that these communities exist on both sides of the border. So some of the issues that we're dealing with are, we have to tie in with what's going on in Sonora. And of interest is their hotspots in the state are also those very same communities. San Luis Rio Colorado, Nogales, Sonora. Luckily right now, Agua Prieta has been a little bit more calm. Agua Prieta borders with Douglas, Arizona. Nogales, Sonora borders with Nogales, Arizona. And San Luis Rio Colorado borders with San Luis, Arizona, Summerton, and Yuma. And so trying to craft messaging to these families and has been so difficult. And in addition, the lack of access to healthcare. There are some true heroes out in those regions. When we look at the Yuma region, you have the Regional Center for Border Health, you have Campesinos Sin Fronteras, you have Sunset Community Health Center that are so important to providing care in those communities. But I think if we look at the overall numbers, it's very, very difficult. I was looking at, for instance, the population of Summerton, Arizona, 16,500 more or less. And the number of active cases this morning was 1,861. So it's practically over 10% of their population is affected with COVID. You can look at the same thing with Nogales, ambos Nogales. You can look at the same thing with Cochise County. So I think those are some of the issues that I do have to say that we do have daily communication and exchange of information with Sonora. That is one area that I will proudly say that Arizona leads the border from California to New Mexico, Texas, the type of communication that we do have with Sonora and sharing the information. Another thing that's been really important is all the information that we have regarding COVID has been translated into Spanish and is on our websites. It's available to anybody who wants that information, all the way from PSAs, both in English and in Spanish, and then signage that we have. So that, I guess I kind of look at, well, what are the areas I can give a plus? And I can say that the department really has gone all out in making sure that all the information we have is available both in English and in Spanish to our communities. I think it's important also to understand the role that the Arizona Department of Health Services plays within the public health setting or the healthcare setting within our state, because we work really closely with our county health departments that have local jurisdiction. And for instance, dealing with the issues right now in Yuma County and Santa Cruz County and in Cochise County, we've been actually hosting a weekly call with each of those counties and with their counterparts on the Mexican side to try to get a better handle on how we can try to slow this wildfire that's burning right now. So those are some of the issues that we deal with, and I do have to say that as I communicate with our colleagues in California, New Mexico, and Texas, it's the very same issues. Along the border region is its own animal. So I'll stop there.
Thank you, Liz. Thanks so much for all of that information. Dr. Castañeda, you're on the front lines battling this crisis as a healthcare provider. You're working in some of the hardest hit communities in Arizona. How is COVID-19 affecting the families you care for as a physician?
First of all, thank you for having me. I want to, first of all, send my condolences to those families that have lost loved ones to this virus, and also to my colleagues who work in healthcare settings. Right now, we are in a crisis, and I agree with all the panelists. We are in a crisis, and in terms of healthcare workers, it's taking a toll on us, and we can only do so much, unfortunately. And our hospital's all filling up. I'm currently working in the hospital, taking care of newborns, and some of our moms are coming in who are COVID-19 positive. So we're scrambling at times to figure out how to manage these situations. But over the last few weeks, when I was in clinic over in Maryville, we saw that surge happen before our very eyes. Families where a mom would come in with three of her kids, one of them with fevers, breathing fast. I knew this family because this one patient has a history of anxiety. So the combination of anxiety in the setting of the virus can really take a toll on the family. But not only that, the father, who was not there, is on chemotherapy, is receiving cancer treatment, he's immunosuppressed, and the family is just incredibly worried, living in a small apartment. And so that distancing is almost impossible for a lot of our families. And so stories like those continue. A lot of our families, unfortunately, because of those disparities, even pre-COVID, right, we see diabetes rates, not only in our adults, the parents of or grandparents of the patients that I'm seeing, diabetes, it could be COPD, obesity. All of these are risk factors that are going to put them at risk of getting sicker if they do contract this virus. As the data is showing, if you take a close look at the hospitalizations, those are turning to, in terms of going predominantly Latino, Hispanic. And so you're gonna see that over the next couple of weeks, unfortunately. And those down the line are going to translate into losses. And we really, really need to get that accurate data to really understand what's going on, getting those the testing capabilities out to our communities. As Senator Rios mentioned, that blitz that happened in Maryville over the last two Saturdays, it's clear, because that's exactly what I was seeing in our clinic down the street. So to have more of those alliances between either nonprofits, the city of Phoenix, some of the labs, to provide very accessible testing and affordable, because again, a lot of our families are afraid of reaching out to get care because of not having insurance, being undocumented. They are scared. And not only that, but they are scared of the outcome. They're scared of going to the hospital. I did have a patient that I directed to the hospital. Mom was very, very scared of what that would mean. And that's based on my years of that feeling of not being able to trust our medical care system because of provided that culturally appropriate care, and also the financial consequences of what would happen if they are admitted for a couple of days in the hospital and in terms of financially. I like to move over to more of those direct effects as well. Asthma is something to consider. There are disparities in terms of our children in urban centers who do have asthma, who can get sick with this virus. I saw a similar case a couple of weeks ago. So making sure that they are talking to the doctor about having those inhalers, having their medications that they routinely use, because those emergent situations may happen. And then apart from that, mental health, I think I mentioned earlier, it's going to take a toll on all of us, but particularly our communities, our Latino communities, where there may be a level of depression, for example, in young Latina teenagers. It's the highest rate of any demographic. So how are we going to deal with those emergent situations when their family may get sick with the virus, but really also not being able to access the services that they need moving forward? I think later on we'll talk about maybe some of the solutions that we all can propose to that. Indirect effects, so I call these indirect effects in terms of, we are concerned that children will not be coming in for their vaccination rates. This particularly applies to children under 2 years old, where there already is a disparity in Latino children in Arizona. So we have been, especially in community health centers and Department of Public Health, been very active in trying to vaccinate our children and have them on that schedule to prevent outbreaks in our communities, and so they also don't get sick with things like measles, pertussis. So that is one of our fears, especially in the pediatric world, and that with time we're going to need to address it. And not only that, our children are going to be missing their dental screenings. That's one of the biggest. That's one of the main reasons that children actually are getting sick or need emergent care for an illness, because otherwise they may be healthy, but those caries, those cavities can cause significant pain and illness. And other screenings, and this applies for adults, but screening for anemias in children, lead toxicity, and as you move into adults, thinking about screening for cancers. So we are going to be missing those situations as well, because all these other illnesses are not going to stop suddenly and say, oh, COVID's here. We have to, as physicians and other healthcare workers, keep an eye on everything in addition to COVID. And that has been, and that will continue to be very difficult. And in addition, just lastly, thinking about therapy services for children through either the early intervention program that Arizona runs, how families are going to be accessing those services. And so those would be some of the indirect effects that I, as a physician, am seeing happen already, and down the line will continue to be a big issue. But again, I wanted to just set that context that our communities are really hurting. They are scared. They are frightened. And it's up to all of us, but specifically our officials, and I'm glad that Senator Rios is here to be one of our greatest advocates, to really, really hold everybody accountable and really, really put those people that are behind all these industries that we have in Phoenix that's growing Arizona. It's being fueled by our community. And many of them are living in the shadow, unfortunately. And so we're here to advocate for them. So thank you again for this opportunity. And I'm glad to be learning from all of you. And I hope to continue working and collaborating. Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Castañeda. And I think it's really important to talk about the broader reaching effects of COVID-19 on our community, because this doesn't happen in a vacuum. There's going to be effects that we don't see for months and years, and it's going to take an interdisciplinary and creative approach to take care of our community and make sure that Arizona is still a fantastic place to live and an excellent place to raise a family and be. So knowing that, let's move on to our next topic, which is about some solutions to these challenges we've discussed. Matthew, let's start with you. What are some federal level policy solutions that could help address the impact COVID-19 has had on the Latino community?
Yeah, thanks, Liz. As I mentioned earlier in our conversation, you know, despite what we've heard here tonight about some of the pre-existing disparities and the disproportionate impact, the good news is that we do know that there are policies that state and federal officials have at their disposal that could address some of these and sort of, fix some of the sort of disparities that we're seeing. And over the past several months, UnidosUS has been working diligently to shape and influence both the passage and the implementation of federal COVID legislation, as well as urging states, Arizona's elected leaders, to do more to address the remaining gaps in the state's response. For federal leaders, UNIDOS has advocated for and Congress passed legislation that would expand access to COVID testing for more people and provide states with additional resources to bolster programs that we know already serve Latinos, like Medicaid and CHIP, as Zaida alluded to earlier. where we know more needs to be done, including guaranteeing COVID treatment for all with no cost to patients, to ensure that cost doesn't prevent anyone from seeking necessary treatment, as Dr. Castañeda was alluding to earlier. And particularly for the over 80,000 uninsured Latino kids that we talked about at the beginning of the conversation, it's more important than ever that COVID testing and treatment be widely available to all with no cost sharing to patients. Right now, we know that the Senate is considering the next round of COVID relief. And we also know from recent polling Unidos has done with our partners at SOMOS that Arizona's Latinos overwhelmingly support funding COVID testing and treatment for all. We also know that Congress is currently considering an additional FMAP increase, which would increase the federal investment in state Medicaid programs beyond what's already been done to account for increased enrollment as a result of people losing job-based coverage and things like that that we've talked about. So it's more important than ever right now that Latinos let their elected leaders know what they want included in the next round of coverage, because Congress is debating it and they'll be passing something hopefully sooner rather than later. We also know that there's important steps state leaders can take to respond to some of these issues that we discussed. And recently UnidosUS called on the governor to, as Senator Rios discussed earlier, call a special legislative session given the urgency of this problem and to kind of facilitate a legislative kind of conversation to respond to the existing and the emerging COVID issues that we're seeing in the past several weeks. We've also called on the governor to find swift ways to address some of the demographic data gaps that Senator Rios and others, including Robert Guerrero, have talked about, because without that data, we know that it can mask the full impact of the virus's effects on, you know, different communities, but also different parts of the state. And we need to know where is the best place to start directing resources quickly so that we can get ahead of these problems before they get worse. And we'd also encourage everyone, obviously, to echo those messages, and most importantly, to register to vote. I think voting in the fall for candidates that prioritize Latinos' health, particularly Latino children's health, given what we're seeing, is one of the most straightforward ways to demonstrate to state and federal officials that they have to listen to Latinos' needs. So if you're not registered to vote, I would visit our website at becomeavoter.org to do so. I know, obviously, Zaida probably can speak to some of the children's coverage disparity issues and policy recommendations around that as well, but I'd also encourage you to visit our website at UnidosUS.org to see our new Arizona fact sheet, and you can learn more there. With that, I'll turn it back to you, Liz.
Thanks, Matt. So Zaida, as Matt mentioned, there's federal policy that we can look at to address these issues. There's also state level policy that we can look at. In anticipation of a possible special session and definitely in anticipation of the next legislative session, what are some policies that yourself and Children's Action Alliance advocate for to address these issues?
Sure. So to really echo what Senator Rios and Dr. Castañeda said, the COVID-19 pandemic is exposing the cracks in our system, but these stressors have been compounding for many years and have really been driven by local, state, and federal policy decisions. The crisis that we're facing today is the result of decades and centuries of systemic oppression and failure to adequately invest in prevention, and we will be seeing these effects play out for many years. So we need to look at short-term state solutions, and we need to look long-term at what we're really doing to dismantle those systems. We can start pretty easily by expanding our CHIP income eligibility to at least 250% of the federal poverty level. That's the US median income for CHIP eligibility. But as I mentioned previously, Arizona's threshold is much lower at just 205%. This report by UNIDOS really highlights that having that option would provide coverage to many more children, and in particular to many more Latino children in Arizona. The CHIP 90-day waiting period is currently on pause during the COVID emergency, but Arizona should remove this requirement altogether so that kids can have seamless access to coverage with no gaps. Arizona should also adopt the Immigrant Children's Health Improvement Act, or IKEA, option in both Medicaid and CHIP to provide health coverage to immigrant children, and should follow the lead of other states that have invested state funds to cover children regardless of immigration status. Lastly, Arizona should extend stimulus payments to ITIN filers and families as well, and then look long-term at how our systems are keeping Latino kids out of coverage at the moment.
Thanks, Zaida, for that great information about some state-level solutions. Let's move on to our Q&A session. This has been a fantastic conversation. I'm sure it sparked a lot of discussion. We're going to take some input from our audience, and also UnidosUS has been collecting questions from our attendees that have registered, and so we're going to use these as this part of this session. I'm going to start with Dr. Castañeda. There were multiple questions, I would say more than any other kind of question, about concerns around the reopening of schools. As you know, there's a lot of unknown factors. Recently, the governor passed an executive order appropriating some CARES Act funds to help schools with their plans, but we're all scrambling to try to figure it out. Some of our schools open in just a few weeks. From your perspective as a healthcare provider, what thoughts do you have on how districts can plan for the safety of teachers, students, and their families?
That's a great question. I think the whole country, in terms of the teachers, educators, pediatricians, we're all, and public health departments are trying to figure out what this will look like. There is concern, as you know, children may, with this virus specifically, it affects everybody differently. First and foremost, that seems to be very different than other viruses. In particular, children don't seem to, they seem to have more of the mild symptoms, we would say cold-like or flu-like, but we really don't know the extent of that unless we get more of that accurate data. But many of our children do live in multi-generational homes where they will be bringing the virus home to their abuelo, abuelita, tío, tía. So we have to keep that in mind. And I think with the hesitancy really revolves around that. That yes, maybe kids are able to recover more than the elder population, but they will be bringing the virus home. So bringing the situations of having those gatherings, making sure that schools, I think what it's going to look like would be some kind of hybrid version. So hybrid meaning whether if there is something on campus, having that that distancing that is critically needed, having everybody wear a mask. Older kids, it's totally doable for our high schoolers or middle schoolers to follow those rules. And in our toddlers or in our elementary schools, we see that it is difficult for that to really happen. So that's one of the issues. And then, but I am very, very concerned that if with our telecommunication disparities, I would say, our children do not have, our Latino communities and our poor communities do not have the same kind of access to having effective education. It's already not optimal to have teaching over the internet, but to have it where they can't connect or they don't have a space within their home to really concentrate or because there may be a lot going on and some of the responsibilities they may have in their home and the stress related to that, they're not going to be learning appropriately. And that will only add to the disparities down the line in terms of how our kids will do. So I would say that it probably would have to be a hybrid approach, but our governor, our officials really need to make the masks wearing mandated in all of our communities throughout the state, and then having situations where you would do some kind of symptom checking or tracing in our communities. That has to happen because otherwise what will happen is influenza usually starts to come, it peaks at different times depending on what the strain is on the southern hemisphere, but it can come in September, October, and then as we're hitting November, December, January, it can get really, really bad. So that would be my other push, if I don't have any more time, is to really push for a flu vaccination campaign in getting our children vaccinated.
Thanks, Dr. Castañeda. Our next question is for Robert. The highest rates of infections in Southern Arizona are with people who are aged 22 to 40 years of age, so a younger population. And I'm wondering from the state's perspective, if there's a link as far as the number of young Latinx people that work in the hospitality industry and essential jobs and this sort of rate, this high rate of infection? Are there other factors at play? And is there a solution that the state is talking about as far as making sure that young people know that they need to protect themselves from this illness?
Well, in answer to the first part of the question regarding the hospitality industry, it goes back to the collection of data. You know, for instance, when you get tested, it seems like the only thing they're asking is their name, their age, and that's it. And so, if we're not collecting the data on the front side, then it's almost impossible to get answers to the excellent questions that you're asking right now. And so, that I'm aware of, that type of information is not available. As far as that age group, and believe me, the last 6 weeks that I've had these border calls with Santa Cruz, Yuma, Cochise, and with Northern Sonora, I think that Dr. Marco Antonio Ramirez Wakamatsu from San Luis Rio Colorado said it right, or the best. I mean, he said if anybody knows the formula for getting the messaging across, because it's not just here in Arizona and Southern Arizona or in all of Arizona, because I believe that it's that same age group, 20 to 44, that feels most invincible. And the same exact thing is happening in Mexico. You know, we're looking at how the messaging, you know, even if, and here's one of the things that we've been trying to do. I know that I said earlier that, you know, all Latino families are not homogenous, but I think that one thing that we do all share is the importance of familia. And the, you know, I can't think of any Latino or Latinx family that I've talked to who doesn't talk, you know, about, you know, the wonderful carne asadas or the fiestas that we have. And so I think what we're trying to model messaging for the Latino families is, you know, even if you're not doing it for yourself, you're doing it to protect your abuelita. You're doing it, you know, that favorite tío, because we also know that those, that our families are those that have the highest rates of diabetes, obesity, and hypertension. And so we're trying to craft those messages. You know, you're not doing it for yourself. You're doing it for your family. You're doing it. You know, how would you feel if you got your abuelita sick and it was your fault that she got it? So those are the issues that we're dealing with. But yeah, that's very difficult to try to hit that age group.
Thank you. And we're having a great discussion, but we only have time for one more question. We had a couple questions around this topic, and this is for Zaida. How can our audience members advocate for people who are in detention centers, including the Eloy Detention Center, where at least 132 detainees have tested positive for COVID-19 and one correctional officer has died? What can our audience do to advocate for these people?
That's a great question. There are a number of groups on the ground that are actively looking at the issues of our detention centers, both ICE and our prison systems and our jails, and high rates of COVID infection in those facilities. I think that one way to advocate would be to get connected to one of those groups, and I'd be happy to make email introductions if you want to reach out to me directly. I'm an open book. Another thing is, we really can't stress this enough, register to vote and vote for people who are going to support a criminal justice platform that is restorative and that is humane, and vote down the ballot, I guess I would say too. So don't just look at the federal, but look at, you know, our county attorneys and our other drivers that are putting people in those positions to begin with. So.
Thank you, Zaida. Thanks everybody for submitting those thoughtful questions. And sorry we couldn't answer all of them, but there were so many fantastic ones. This is an extremely challenging time for the state of Arizona and particularly stressful for Latino people who have been disproportionately impacted in all ways by COVID-19. knowing what we know and knowing what we've learned just now, we have to make change. UnidosUS is calling you to action. Contact your state legislators, contact Governor Ducey to ask for a special session to address the many issues of disparity this global pandemic has laid bare in our communities. Like we mentioned before, these issues were here before and they're just made greater by this new challenge. Register to vote and join the permanent early voting list so you can vote from the comfort and the safety of your own home. Follow the CDC guidelines to stop the spread of COVID-19, shelter in place, limit your contact with people outside of your house, and wear a mask in public. Make sure to talk to your friends and family about what you learned today. Your actions can make the difference. I'd like to extend my appreciation to the State Senator, Rebecca Rios, to Zaida Dedolph, Robert Guerrero, Dr. Uriel Castañeda, and Matt Snyder for participating in this conversation today, as well as a thank you to the UnidosUS affiliates in Arizona who continue to do important work to support the Latino community. My name is Liz Salazar, and I thank you for joining us. Stay safe, stay healthy, and stay informed. Have a good afternoon.